Hello everyone, can you see the slides? Are the slides visible to you? Hello Monica, hello Vanita, nice name, hello Jayati, hello Ashish, hello Githika, hello everyone. Guys, perfectly fine. Slides are not visible. Is that so? Guys, is that visible to all of you or it is only for Ashish, I suppose? Buffering? Visible? Okay. Now is this fine? Is it fine now, guys? Come on, I need some responding mode. Everybody, this is the initial time that we have to, you know, we can chit chat about something. Anything that you want to ask me. Let more people sign in, we will surely start with the class. Go on, I can see some PBS name 007. I'm fantastic. Vanita, what about you? Go on, guys. Let more people sign in. Yeah, that's fine. That's great. So, guys, tell me, how are your studies going? Guys, how are your studies going? I believe this is class 12, the senior most level of your school. Just 6-7 months more and then you are out of your school life. No? How do you feel? I mean, like, I believe some of you might be the head boy and the head girl of your school. Okay, how many of you are? My God, JD is perfect, Mr. Perfect, Miss Perfect, I suppose. Okay, anybody else? You're the head girl. So guys, this is something I must tell, that a couple of people are like head boys and head, I mean, Mr. Perfect there. Okay, that's great. So, I believe we have, you know, sufficient number of people. Shall we start the class? With your permission, buddies. Shall we? I need more yes on the chat post. I can see 1, 2, 3, 3 yes. What about more people? Come on. I need more people to activate, you know. Be active. Hello, Manisha. Yeah, that's great. So, what is the heading of the title today? What is the title today? It is aggregate demand, aggregate supply and their components. Sounds heavy, no? It's a pretty easy class. We're going to get upon it as soon as possible. Fine. Let's start the class now. Okay. Here comes the first, and we have the overview of the class. So what you can see, these are the, I mean, what I can say, these are the components. These are the, I mean, topics that we are going to discuss today. In case, meanwhile, if anybody of you having any doubt, please do let me know. In case, this is the rule that I follow in my class. If anybody is not getting anything, even if it is one single student, do stop me then and there itself. Fine? Is that fine? Guys, I can see you. Is that fine or not? Okay, that's great. So, let's start now. Everyone who has joined us late, we are just going to start the class. Shall we? Are you settled down? Okay, great. So, what you can see? I mean, like, this is the aggregate demand. We are, first topic that we are going to talk about is aggregate demand and its components. Fine. So, you know, we have already learned in the micro portion that we have demand. We have been learning about that. Being an economic student, we know what is demand and supply. When we talk about demand, basically we mean an individual's demand, a person's demand, or a single person who is demanding something. So as you can see on the slide, this is a person. Let me put this, I mean, do you like the caricature there? What is? No. Go on. Yeah? Okay, just let me, you know, select the pen. Yeah, it's fine now. And let me, it, yes. So, let's suppose this is me. I don't know that I look so good. So, now suppose, if we are talking about a demand of a single commodity, let me stress on this word. I suppose I striped it out. Okay. If we are talking about single commodity, remember that. Single commodity by an individual. That is a single person demanding something, a single commodity, we regard it as individual demand. As you can see here, it is, let's suppose I am demanding, suppose let it be like shoes. So, since my demand is particularly for shoes, that is one commodity, and since I being an individual, this is my demand, an individual demand. Come on, this is something that we have learned in micro portion. And if I reflect this in a diagrammatic portion, this is the diagrammatic part of my demand. Diagrammatic presentation of my demand. And we of course know that if demand being represented by dx, x means the commodity, the demand for a commodity. Fine? And it's a function. Function means that it is dependent on. Now what are the factors that it is dependent on? It is or the price of that commodity, the price of some other commodity, income and taste and preference. Come on, I'm not going to get into all those things because since we have already learned them in the micro portion, and this is what we are going for the macro portion. So I thought of, you know, reviving or recalling macro or deriving macro from micro. So do you guys agree till my point? This is what we have learned in micro. Is that clear to all of you now? Because if this is clear, then only we are going to move ahead. Fine. Now what if, just a food for thought to everybody. Guys, listen to me very carefully. It's a thought. What if I consider all the people, I can see Vanita, I can see Manisha, John Nash, I believe Divya, Nikhil. If I take all of you, all of your demand, if I consider all the demands for all the commodities, what it will be? Basically what I'm doing, I'm trying to sum up all the demands. So let me take you to the next slide. Here you have it. So aggregate, the word aggregate, till now we were talking about the individual demand. An aggregate demand means the sum total of demands. Fine, sum total. That is when we ask of the demand or the individual demand of for all the commodities. So that is what you can see. I mean, like I have already emphasized on the word sum total. So similarly here you can see demands by all the people in an economy. Now what is an economy? Economy is a country. Let it be a country. In a layman term, it's a country. Fine. Or a nation. When I sum up the demands for all the people in an economy, for all the goods. So guys, what are the words that I'm stressing on? All the people, of an economy, all the goods. Fine. So this becomes an aggregate demand. Is that clear to all of you? A sum total of individual demand. Now, what you can see, I mean like, we have like four people here, one of blue color, one of green color, one of yellow, and the two, I mean like the last one is of gray color. So these people are households. So similarly, when I'm talking about an economy, all the people of an economy can be of four sectors. I mean like one, I mean the first sector is like they can be either belonging to the households, they can be the investors, they can be the government, or they can be the foreign sector. So what basically what I want to say is, in an economy, since we know the sectors of economy, so if we talk about demand with respect to sectors, then we have four sectors. We already know that: household, investors, government and foreign sector. So now let's think over it. Why a household will demand something, why an investor will demand something, why a government will demand something, and why a foreign sector will demand something? Have you ever thought of it? This is what is there on the slide. Why household demands? Demands basically for the consumption purposes, to feed themselves, to consume something. Let it be like the cloth, the houses, the TV, the internet connection that you are all, I mean, having now, or it's meditation subscription, anything that you are consuming. It's a bus ticket, everything. Similarly, for investors, what they are looking for? Why they demand? They demand for making investment. The demand for investment purposes. So as you can see here, this is a demand for investment purposes. Now let's move to the government. What do you think? Why government requires, why government demands something? Come on, we obviously think that government is something that will provide or supply us with something. It can be services, it is something like kind of roads, it can be like street lights, anything. But why government demands? Government demands basically for the goods and services that it can render, or it can produce something, or it can add value to that. And it will basically, what I can say is like it produces something and then it delivers that for the welfare of the society. For example, let it be the road that we use. It is basically for the welfare. Fine. The street light, the schools, the hospitals, whatever the kind of things that the government is providing us, it's basically because of the welfare purposes. So government also demand goods, you see. Similarly, for the foreign sector, they demand goods and services for the purpose of exports or imports. Basically, what they do is like they all these people, they demand for some goods and services, and then they add value to those. And then finally, the output is sold. The foreign sector, they exports, they imports. So this is basically the demand is. So what I have done on this slide is basically what I can say is like I have categorized the demand as per the sectors. So guys, we have four sectors, we know that. One is like household, the second is investors, the third one is government, and the fourth one is foreign sectors. Is that clear to all of you? Yes or no? Be specific. If it is clear, say yes. If it is not, say no. Yeah, that's great. I'm getting a good response, guys. Either you are very intelligent or I'm not very good teacher. Just joking, come on. So accordingly, what we can say is like we have specific names. We say these are the technical terms. Let it be like the for household. We say it's a private consumption expenditure. Is that clear? Private consumption expenditure. For when we are talking about investments, investors about private investment expenditure. So it will make any difference. Like here we have consumption because household demand for consumption, and here we have investment because investors demand for investment. That's it. Now, government, when we talk about government, why they demand? So the demand by government is regarded as government expenditure. Fine. And simply by foreign sector is regarded as. So guys, we started with the point that in an economy, the aggregate demand can be segregated into four sectors and according to their demands. Fine. Till this point, we are clear about this. Now, what if I put them in an equation form? As you can see here, this is basically an equation. Fine. Now, in this equation, what I did, I put aggregate demand is equal to consumption, that is for the household, investment, that is for the investors, government, that is basically for the government expenditure, and export minus import, that is basically the net exports. So we are in a position to know that we know the meaning of aggregate demand, we know the equation of aggregate demand. Fine. So from next time onward, when we are talking about aggregate demand, this is the equation that should come to our mind. It is C plus I plus G plus X minus M. Clear to all of you? Anything that you want to talk about till this point? Come on guys, what about the other people? What happened? Not clear? Yeah, I need more active participation. Yeah, okay, fine. Now let's move to the next slide. So what we are going to do in the rest of the class is basically we are going to talk about the components. So you see, I mean, like I have arranged the components on the left side. You see that private consumption expenditure, private investment expenditure, government expenditure, net exports. So these are the four components of aggregate demand. The rest of the class, we are going to basically talk about what are these components. We are going to have a detailed discussion over it. So let's start with the first one. As you can see, these three are dead. So we are going to talk about this one. So let's first tackle this part. So what is this? This is basically the total expenditure incurred by all the households of an economy on all the types of goods and services. It's quite simple. Fine. Basically for the consumption, basically for by the households. So these are the two words. Guys, look at me. These are the two words, household and consumption purpose. This comprises the private consumption expenditure. Fine. Now, be very attentive for next 2 minutes. I'm going to give you this is a very important portion of this class. Be very attentive, everybody, and look at the slide. So now if I bifurcate consumption expenditure, as you can see on the slide, I have done that. The first part is regarded as autonomous consumption expenditure. And the second one is regarded as induced consumption expenditure. Now, in order to understand the difference between these two, you need to understand the difference between autonomous and induced. Anybody who can tell me what is the meaning of autonomous word? Anything. Any guesswork will do the work. What do you think? What is the meaning of the word autonomous? Is it fixed? Okay. I will consider that. Shodhika, find the else. Anybody else? Anything? Come on. Guys, help me out. What is the meaning of the word autonomous? Any guesswork? Shodhika says it is fixed. Anybody else? No one. Not dependent of. Very good. Let me clap for Vanita. Very good, Vanita. Very good. So it is not dependent of. That is independent. Very good, Jayati. So in this case, it is not dependent of. So a portion of expenditure that is not dependent of something. I am keeping that something hidden. So as of now, what we know is that this portion of expenditure is not dependent on something. Like something, let's keep that intact. On the other hand, the word induced means dependent. Fine. So basically the difference between autonomous and induced is being dependent and being not dependent. So the not dependent portion is autonomous and dependent portion is induced. Now let's get back to this word something. And what is the something is? It is basically the disposable income. Do you understand the meaning of disposable income? Anybody? What is that? Income that we can dispose? Come on, who is going to give dispose the income? Yes, the income that is left for to be spent. Very good, Ram. That is the income that is available for consumption. The amount. Suppose, let me give you a hint. Suppose, let's talk about Amit. My monthly salary, suppose my monthly salary is, I'm taking it fictitious, so don't consider that. Suppose it is 10,000 bucks. Oh my god. Fine. Suppose it is like 10,000. Now I have to pay taxes. Suppose let it be like 900 rupees. Fine. So what is the amount that I am left with? The left out amount is 9,100 rupees. So this is my, what is this? This is my disposable income. That is the income, the portion of income that I can spend. It is available to me for consumption purpose. Fine. So what we can say is like autonomous expenditure. Let me take you back to the slide. So autonomous expenditure is not dependent on the disposable income. And induced consumption expenditure is basically dependent on the disposable income. Fine. That is why, since autonomous portion is independent, or quoting Shodhika, what she said mentioned is fixed. So that is why we regard autonomous part as bar, that is C bar. The bar means it is constant. So let me write the word constant. And we denote autonomous expenditure as C bar. That means irrespective of the disposable income, irrespective of the income that I have. Okay, now let's get back to this, the original example. Suppose in this case, since my monthly salary is 10,000 rupees, even if it becomes like something like this, I believe this becomes, it will be fantastic. Even if it is like this, my autonomous consumption expenditure will remain independent of this. Fine. Even if it is 10,000, or if I am not earning anything, or if I am earning like 10 lakhs, the autonomous portion of the consumption will remain exactly the same. Guys, is that point clear to all of you? What I mentioned is autonomous expenditure will be independent of income level. Fine. Great. On the other hand, let's talk about the induced part. Induced means that it is dependent on the disposable income. And as the disposable income will increase, what I can say is that induced consumption expenditure will also increase. So that is why you can see this, these arrows. These arrows move in a positive manner. If it increase, then consumption, induced expenditure is also increasing. If it is decreasing, disposable income is falling, then what I can say is induced consumption expenditure is also falling. So what we can say it's a positive relationship, because both the variables are moving in the same direction. Fine. Now, since we regard autonomous expenditure C bar and we regard in or we denote induced consumption expenditure by small c y or small c y d. Y d basically means disposable income and small c. So basic difference between autonomous and induced is this is a capital C. It is a capital C. And here what we have is a small c. Fine. Now if I put them together, as you can see here. Okay guys, I do understand this is quite, you know, it's quite messy. Let me drop all these things. Now it is clear. Now if I put this part together, this is your autonomous part. Let me write that. And this portion is your induced part. So basically if I bring them together, it becomes C. That is, C means the consumption expenditure. You see that. You have it here. So this is your private consumption expenditure. It is C bar plus, okay, plus small c y d. That is, C is equal to C bar plus small c y d. Fine. With this, we are done with the consumption part. In the next slide, we are going to move for the private investment expenditure. Let's move ahead. Yes. Now we have private expenditure, private investment expenditure. Again, it is quite similar to what we have for the consumption. This is a planned, you know, planned total expenditure. That is the expenditure that the different investors have already planned for. Okay, suppose, let me give you the word, the meaning of this word. Suppose this month I plan that I have to invest 20,000. So it is a planned total expenditure. Planned. So in this manner, all the investors in an economy, when they plan their total expenditure, and why they plan this expenditure for creation of capital goods. And who can give me the meaning of the capital goods? Anyone? What exactly is the meaning of capital goods? No one? Come on, that's a shock to me. Come on guys, you guys know the meaning of capital goods? No one? Think of buildings, infrastructure, machinery. I see people typing, but I cannot see anything on the chat post. Come on. Capital goods are basically goods. Yes, goods that are used for producing other goods. Very good, Vanita. A thumbs up to you. Yes, exactly. Machinery. So these goods, I mean, the investors, they think over it. They plan their expenditure in a manner that they, you know, what I can say is like they create the capital goods. Fine. So that these goods will be used for the production of the other goods. And hence, in a manner, in this manner, they will earn profit. So that is why the basic motive of investors, if I ask you, is basically the profit motive. Come on, we all are rational people. Nobody of us is going to make our investment just because of the welfare purpose. Who all agree with me? Is there anyone who is going to do it for, I mean, rational basis? Is there anyone who is going to do it for just for the sake of welfare? Yeah, that's the government. I mean, is that? Yes, exactly. Exactly. That's what the point is. We as individual investors, we are not going to talk about anything that is not profit. Fine. Profit is something that we are always guided by. Okay. Now, similar to the consumption expenditure, we can bifurcate, as you can see there in the branch diagram, we can bifurcate investment expenditure into two manner. It is, the first one is autonomous, again the same thing, induced. Now, as we have already learned the meaning of autonomous, that is independent of something, and induced, the word induced means that it is dependent on something. Now, in this case, that something is different. You know, I mean, in the consumption expenditure, we talked about the dependency on the disposable income. But here, it is not only the disposable income, it is another component we have. You see that? We have it for R. This small r is basically what? Anybody? Let me check it out. Who all can say what is R? Interest. Very good, Yamini. It is interest. It is the rate of interest. So, what we can say is like investment is basically dependent on the interest rate and the disposable income. So we have two components now. Fine. In consumption expenditure, we had only one factor, that is the disposable income. Whereas in case of investment, we have two factors, that is the rate of interest and as well as the disposable income. So this is what we have here. Now, autonomous, again, we know that this is the I bar. This is denoted by I bar because this is the level of investment that is irrespective of the rate of interest and the disposable income. Guys, be attentive what I am saying. I am repeating my sentence again. Autonomous investment expenditure, this is one of the definitions that you can write in case if it appears in the board examination. Autonomous investment expenditure is that particular type of investment expenditure that is independent of or that is irrespective of the interest rate and the disposable income. So these are the two, I mean this part is independent of it, and that is why we denote I and we put a bar over that. Bar means constant. Fine. On the other hand, induced part, it shares a what? It shares a negative relationship. You see that? It shares a negative relationship with the R and it shares a positive relationship with Y. So let me write it down. You can see here, this is the crux that we have. The negative relationship with the rate of interest, because when R falls, income, investment rises. It becomes more profitable, you see that? Fine? It becomes more profitable. You see, I mean, like whenever the rate of interest falls, the investment are more. Fine. And whenever the rate of interest increases, we have investment, the investment falls. Similarly, when we have more income, people will have more money and they will invest. When people have less income, they will have less incentive because they have to complete the, you know, what kind of, I mean, they have to fulfill your consumption expenditure first. Obviously, I mean, as a human being, first I have to consume myself. First I have to feed myself. Only when I can, I mean, once I have done with the consumption portion, only then I can invest. Because investment is done with the leftover portion. Any doubt, any point here that you want to know? Is it clear to all of you? I mean, like, are you guys getting this? Anybody? Ram, what about you? Fine, that's great. I must say I have a very good batch, you know. That's fantastic, guys. Okay. So now let's move ahead. This is a government expenditure. It's quite simple. I mean, like this is again a planned expenditure that is incurred by the government. Let's stress on this word. I'm highlighting the important words, guys. Please pay attention on particular words. So these are the expenditure. This is the expenditure that is incurred by government on consumption and in and why? To enhance public welfare. And basically by public welfare we means the services that enhances the welfare of the whole economy and it improves the growth rate of the economy. So basically growth rate means the rate at which the economy is growing. Okay, how many of you have, I mean recent newspaper headlines, we had this: India is growing at the rate of 8.9%. Anybody has came across this particular news headlines? No one? The growth rate of India is 8.9%. That's a massive growth rate, I must tell that. Okay. So, okay, Harry, is that 8.5? I will surely check it out once. What I can recall is like it was 8.9. Okay, fine. If that's a mistake, I will commit, I will surely admit that. Anyway, so basically, it's basically the difference in terms of fraction. So 8.5 or 8.9, but that's a massive, huge, you know, growth rate, what I can say. So now let's see what are the bifurcation that we have for government expenditure. Now government expenditure, again, it consists of investment and consumption. You see that, as we have already talked about, that government consume as well as invest. So that accordingly, we can bifurcate government expenditure in two parts, investment expenditure and consumption expenditure. Now, what is exactly investment expenditure? Why government invest? You see, government invest basically with the purpose of rendering welfare. Just strike out the portion of profit motive here. Government is not going to, you know, obviously it does do that. It is not always. For example, putting up a hospital, or let it be like opening up schools. So these things, I mean, like hospitals, schools, roads, what does this kind of infrastructure helps? These infrastructure build up the human capital. I mean, we have healthy people, we have healthy human capital, we have educated and literate human capital. So this human capital will work, and further the future growth rate will increase. Fine. So this is basically the welfare motive of the government. On the other hand, when government invests for consumption expenditure, it consume investment like defense. Fine. And accordingly, it goes for purchase of guns and some such sort of like that. So again, in this consumption expenditure also, government has the welfare motive because it want to protect the citizens of a nation. So this is the consumption, this is the investment. So again, both the things are guided by the public welfare motive. Is that clear to all of you? Fine. Okay, let's move ahead. The next portion that we have, it is basically the net exports. So the net exports, basically it is export minus import. It is nothing more than that. It's a difference basically. So now let's read this part, because this definition is quite, it's slightly tricky. Everybody pay attention. It's a difference between demand for domestically produced goods by ROW means. ROW means, I have already taught that. Come on, who is going to give me the answer for that? It is rest dash dash. Yes, exactly. It is rest of the world. Very good, Vanita. So this is basically the goods that we produce within our nation. It is demanded by the rest of the world. Rest of the world means every single country except that particular nation. Suppose if we are talking about India, then all the countries that we have in the world except India. Fine. And the demand for goods and services produced abroad by the residents of a country. So what I can say is, like the first portion, exports, these are domestically produced. Let's suppose let's talk about, we are talking in terms of India. We're talking in terms of India. So all those goods that are produced in India, within India. Let's understand this with the reference of India. So all those goods that we are producing within India, and it is demanded by, let it be like rest of the world. So we are basically selling them. Fine. So this is our exports. Now if I reverse this, that is goods produced in ROW. Fine. Goods produced in rest of the world, and it is being demanded by us. Demanded by whom? The Indians. Fine. So it will be imports. So if we put this, let me magnify this minus sign, it is already there, but since it is, not visible, so net export is basically export minus import. So we are end of this part. Now we know that aggregate is basically a demand, sum total of all the demands, and finally it is basically, it has four components: consumption, investment, expenditure, consumption, investment, government, and net export. Fine. Now, basically, we are going to talk about consumption expenditure and consumption function. So now there are two things: consumption and investment. These are the two important, what I can say is like focus area, because with the help of investment and consumption, we are going to learn about many laws like Keynes' psychological law of consumption. Then we are going to talk about MPC and APC. So these are basically this is a framework that we are talking about. Fine. This is something that we have already learned about. Fine. This is a recall part. You know that we have already talked about. So if I regard this as, what is this? This is my consumption function. And what I did here, I have represented it consumption as a function of this. Come on. This is a mathematical equation that we always write. Remember, I mean, like how many of you can recall this part? Y is equal to function of X. If we write it like this, AX plus B. So in this case, Y is a function of X. In this case, consumption is a function of disposable income. So this becomes my consumption function. Clear to you? All of you? No. Lost somewhere? Is that clear? Getting the point? If you are not getting the point, please do let me know, guys. Okay. Now, we are in the basically in the some important topic that we are going to do. Till now, we know that consumption is a positive function. You see that consumption is a positive function. That means whenever disposable income will increase, consumption will also increase. But having said that, we know that both of them rises together, both of them falls together. But have you ever thought of what will change? What will be the pace of change? What will be the, I mean, at what rate does consumption will change? Look, what I mean is, both of them will rise. Both of them will rise, both of them fall. But point is, what is the rate of change in consumption when we have change in disposable income? So this is a point that you have to think about. Fine. Let me take you to the next slide. You have it here. Suppose this is the increase in income or increase in disposable income. Let it be anything. Now, this much increase, you see that, is just try to note the height of this arrow. This height of this much increase in consumption brings just this much of change in consumption. What you have to note here is increase here and increase here. Both the things are increasing, but one is this much, the height of income is this much, and the height of consumption is this much. So what I basically want to say is that a bigger change in income brings a small change in consumption. Is that clear to all of you? Shall I repeat my sentence? A bigger change in income brings a small change in consumption. Now, where is the rest of the portion? Where is the rest of the portion? What's that? It is half. No, it can be half. It cannot be half. It can be half. I'm just trying to show you the picture here. Yes, exactly. It is savings. So what I want to say is, when our income increases, the consumption do not rise in the same manner. Why? Because some of the rise in the income perks in terms of saving. Now let me fill this part. It's saving. Fine. That is what the point here is. It is the proportion of increase in income is more than the proportion of increase in the consumption. Fine. This is what the crux is. With a rise in income, propensity. Now what is the meaning of the word propensity? That is a tendency. It's nothing more than the word tendency. As our income rises, we tend to consume at a lesser rate. Is that clear? Guys, listen to me very carefully. With the rise in income, as our income rises, we tend to consume at a lesser rate. Why? Because we have to save. Because we tend to save. Because whole of the increase in income is not spent. Or that is what a part of income is saved. So moment we have more income, we have the saving, the concept of saving step into. Clear? So now, yeah, since you can see that the rise in income, this is the saving portion, this part is consumed. So this is what we have. This is the basic, I can say, the crux or the point over which the Keynes based his psychological law of consumption. Why psychological law? Why the word psychological here? Because Keynes says it is basically into the head of people. This psychologically they are driven. The psychological driven. They say we were initially in a position we were consuming well. But since now the income has increased, we are much better off. We are well off. Now we can save. And why we save? We save because of the future uncertainties. Is that clear? So Keynes says it is all in the psychology. So psychological law of consumption. Clear to you? All of you? Is that so? Yep. Yes, great. Okay, guys. Now, let's move ahead. This is what the word is, propensity to consume, the tendency of people to consume their income or increase in their income. Fine. Let's move to this part. Quickly, we have two portion here. One is average propensity to consume, one is marginal propensity to consume. The propensity word means tendency. Now, what is average propensity? It is refers to the ratio of consumption to the level of disposable income. That is basically the consumption, the ratio. Consumption upon disposable income. Whereas, in case of marginal propensity to consume, we have the change in consumption. To highlight the word change, it is change, or the marginal change or the marginal effect in consumption with respect to the marginal effect in terms of disposable income. This is what you have. That is why we have put the sign of delta. Fine. Delta means a minute change, a small, a little change. So come on, this is something that we have already learned about the concept of average and marginal. Remember, average product, marginal product, marginal cost, average cost, you know, that is the case. So with this, we now, you know, solve this example. You can see that we have the income like this. We have the consumption. We have been given both the things. Now we have to calculate APC. It's quite simple. We just have to basically divide consumption by income disposable, and this is what we can say. This means that this economy, averagely, it consumes 80%. I'm repeating myself. If we say this is the 80%, average propensity to consume is 80%, we say that this economy is having a high consumption. It's a high consumption. That is, only 20% of the income is saved. Now, let me put a food for thought. What is the problem? Guys, listen to me very carefully. Look at me, guys. What I'm saying, if had it been a case like APC is equal to 20%, in what manner these two scenarios are different? In a country where it is 80%, we have more consumption, and in a country where we have 20%, we have less consumption. Fine. Which country will be developed and which country will be underdeveloped? This is a high order question thinking. Please think over it. Fine. Now let me take you to the next slide. We have to have an example of marginal consumption, and this is quite simple. You see that you have delta C, delta disposable income, and this is what we have. You simply divide it, we have this part. Now let me interpret the meaning of this 40%. It says every 100 rupees or 100 unit change in income will bring 40% change in consumption. Do you see that? If the change in income is by 100 units, or let it be 100 rupees, $100, anything, then consumption will change by 40 unit. So the rest portion will be saved. You see that? Okay, guys. Now let me put you a hot question. This is, if the ratio of MPC and MPS is given as like 3:1, calculate the total increase in income if investment increases by 100 crore. So now let's quickly do it. Since I'm running short of time, let's quickly do it. We have this equation, MPC plus MPS is equal to 1. And this is the given equation that we have. If we solve it like this, I'm just leaving it here itself. In case you guys have any doubt, please, you can buffer to this part in the recording version and you can see it. In case you have any doubt, we will surely meet in the next class. We are going to discuss about this. Fine. Let's have a quick thing what we are going to learn in the next class. These are topics that we are going to talk about. We are going to talk about the aggregate supply and its component. Aggregate demand portion will be over. Then we have aggregate supply, saving, so the propensity to save. In this class, we have learned about propensity to consume. And also, we are going to learn about the concept of saving function. In case you want to have a brush up, then you can refer to the study material of lesson 2, chapter 4 on meritation.com. This will be basically the name of the chapter is income determination. Fine. So, guys, this is the time for, it's a time for me to say goodbye to all of you. Stay healthy and keep studying. Everybody. Bye-bye.